It is 5 o'clock. I will call this meeting of June 7th, 2021 to order, and we will lead off with Reverend Ben Porter with our invocation.
Thank you, sir. Council members, mayor, how do you do, everyone? Let us pray. Father, we thank you for the opportunity to come before you and to conduct the business of the city, Father. You said that all men will stand before God. You said that all blessings and promotion come from above. And so everyone that sits in these seats, Father, are ordained and positioned and appointed by you. And so we honor them, we reverence them, Father. And we thank you for their sacrifice and their dedication. And we thank you, Lord God, for reminding them also that we all will stand before Christ to give an account one day. And we thank you for the truth of your word. We thank you for the loyalty of their hearts to abide by that truth and to conduct the business of this city, from every rich man to every poor man, to every person from European to Asian to African countries that make up this city. We thank you, Lord God, that truth and justice will reign in the hearts and every decision that is made in this council, Father, that it comes from you, that you grant wisdom, that you give accountability, that you bless and favor. We give you honor, Father, for the opportunity to hold these positions and to be a part of this community. We ask that your will be done and your kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. So thank you for blessing this hour. Thank you for blessing all that represent this council in this city. We ask you to bless them and bless those that they love. And we give you honor for it. It's in Jesus' name we give praise and honor and thanks. Let everybody say, amen. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
The first of our presentations this evening in this study session will be from the Cape Girardeau Public Library Board of Trustees.
It's good to see everyone. Thank you all for having me. My name is Stacey Johan Lane, and I'm privileged to serve as the president of the Cape Girardeau Public Library Board of Trustees. We oversee the management, affairs, and policies of the library. We're a policymaking board, and we're also fiscally responsible for how the library's funds are spent. So I sent you guys all this in a report. I'm sure you've already read it, but I did want to highlight a couple of the things that we've been working on in the last year or two, because we've been up to a whole lot at the public library. We hired a new director in 2018, Katie Hill Earnhardt, to replace longtime library director Betty Martin. We were so fortunate to find such a forward-thinking, visionary library director who came to us from Kansas, and I'm really proud of how she's led our library through COVID-19 and the new ideas that she's brought that help us better serve our community. We've also developed and overseen the implementation of a 3-year strategic plan. We have 9 board members with so many amazing perspectives and experience, and all of that really comes together to make sure that we're guiding the library in a good direction. We also put a new city resident, non-library district resident card in place to respond to those City of Cape residents who reside outside of the municipal library district. This has been a long-running challenge for the library. You guys are nodding so you're familiar with it. We were so happy to be able to find a solution that everyone on the board felt good about, and it's received a lot of positive acclaim from patrons at the library as well. We also created a partnership with Cape Girardeau Public Schools to issue cards to K-12 students to encourage youth library cards. This is in keeping with our strategic plan, and we look forward to continuing and further developing that partnership as well. We've consolidated and clarified the library's policies. Sounds tedious, but it's been really useful and valuable to make sure that we have all of our I's dotted and our T's crossed. We've also put together long-range financial forecasting to guide library budgetary decisions. We always welcome input from Cape Girardeau citizens and library patrons at all of our meetings. We meet on the first Thursday of the month, bright and early at 7 a.m., and on the agenda every time is time for public comment. So the public is always welcome to come and share what their experience is as a citizen of our community or as a library patron to make sure that we're hearing from everyone as we serve on the library board. Do you guys have any questions for me?
Can't think of any. I think you're doing a great job.
We've got amazing library staff and some really dedicated board members.
Where would one find the information on the new resident but non-resident
library card?
Yeah.
I'm going to defer to our wonderful director, Katie. Katie, is that going to be on the library's website?
I have a lot. I'm in Ward 4, which is one of those wards where we see that a lot. So I know for one, I would love to have that,
yes,
that information so that I could
answer. Absolutely. On our website, you can find about how to get a library card. There's actually a link for that. And then there's a wonderful flow chart that says, are you a city resident? And if so, follow this link.
Oh, okay.
And do you work for the city or do you attend a K-12 school? And it'll tell you what kind of card you qualify for and how to apply for it.
Okay, awesome. Yeah. Thank you, guys.
And lastly, we'd love to see folks at the ribbon cutting this Wednesday at 10:30 as we celebrate the new community Wi-Fi in our public parks in partnership with our wonderful Parks and Recreation Department to really celebrate that service being live and active. So thank you all so much.
Thank you. We are now going to have a coronavirus state and local recovery funds presentation. I think Dustin is going to do that.
Yes. Honorable Mayor and Council, over the past few months, the federal government has passed legislation regarding putting some funds back into state and local governments and get some spending back into the various areas within the United States. The city of Cape Girardeau is actually the beneficiary of these funds with approximately $8.2 million. I'll get to a little further than that, but the city manager, Meyer, myself, and staff have worked on this project to evaluate the interim final rule on the applicable areas we can spend these funds and make sure we are doing so in an appropriate manner, but also doing the best we can to help our citizens throughout the course of all this and make sure the funds are spent in a wise manner. So there are a couple main areas that these funds can be used for. The first one is the replacement of lost public sector revenues. The next is investment in water, sewer, / stormwater, and broadband infrastructure. The support of public health response, negative economic impacts, and serving the hardest hit in our community. The last one is a premium pay for essential workers. The first one I want to talk about is the lost public sector revenue. This act, and by that I mean the interim final ruling, allows recipients facing budget shortfalls to use the payments for that purpose. Defining the revenue source eligible for replacement focuses sources that are generated by economic activity and are available for government services. So they're fairly specific on what can be construed as eligible for public sector revenue recovery. It also states that we can utilize one of two methods to calculate our growth rate. We can either use 4.1%, which was a number generated by the federal government, or the higher of that, or the three fiscal years prior growth. So with lost sector revenue, they actually put the formulas in there within this interim final ruling on calculating this. As stated, it is used for taxes and revenues that are based on economic activity and growth. We centralize that along our general fund revenue, our casino, hotel, motel, restaurant, and motor fuel taxes. Those were very hard hit due to economic inactivity throughout the course of the last 12 to 15 months. The other thing is they have us set a base year, which we used as our fiscal year on June 30th of 2019. That was the last full fiscal year we had prior to coronavirus hitting. So that 12 months is considered our base year for calculating what our losses actually were. When we was $37,538,000 and change. When you do the counterfactual revenue, which is those calculations, it comes out to supposed to be approximately $42,128,000. That leaves us a shortfall of about $4,589,000 is what our counterfactual losses were due to coronavirus. The next piece that we will talk about is infrastructure. The Act clearly defines that these monies can be utilized for investments within our water, sewer, stormwater, and broadband infrastructure within the city. They give us a very wide latitude on this to make sure we focus in on where we feel our community needs it the most. They didn't specify as long as it's within this infrastructure set. So that really gives staff and council an opportunity to focus it where we really need it. In 2015, while I wasn't here, I have been researching this quite a lot in the last few weeks. We had a study done for infiltration and inflow. Which is a major problem this city is facing within its sewer system. We have a significant amount of inflow of stormwater within our sewer system. In the study, with the remaining part as we sit now, because some work has been done on that massive project, there's still about $8.1 million we still have to do to get this completely cleaned up based on that study. And the areas of main concern are the mainline rehabilitation and manhole sealing that are what encompasses this study and work needing to be done. So within the infill and infiltration, on the chart there you will see, these are numbers provided by Public Works, and thank you for them for putting them together. So total flow within our sewer plant is approximately 2.2 billion gallons a year. That averages out to about 6.23 million gallons a day. That is a significant amount of flow that we run through. One of the things we did to calculate what the true infiltration of stormwater was is find dry days where there was no flooding or anything like that, where there was no seepage within our system. We took all those days and averaged them out. We estimate our dry weather infiltration, our dry weather flow to be about 4.1 million. And that leaves us at about, without INI, 1.5 billion gallons a year. That is our true flow rate when we're running 2.2 million, billion a year. So we have approximately, based on our estimation, 750 million gallons of stormwater flowing through our sewer plant per year, which with the nice facility that we have there, putting that extra strain on the plant, not going to last near as long, and we'd like to keep that going. That equates out to about a third of our flow each year is due to stormwater. So it shows the significance of the problem. And just for a bit of comparison, if we actually did that flow and charged it to a customer, each year would be about $3 million worth of charges. So that's not what we would actually get if we fix this infiltration. But what it will do is it limits what we can do for expansion. I know at various times we talk about economic development and different things like that. We're taking up $3 million a year in expansion just by stormwater. So it's a major issue that we really need to address.
Just another point, Dustin, before you go on, the one of the real threats in this is if we were to exceed our capacity of our existing plant. So if we were to overflow our plant, then that's called a violation, and Department of Natural Resources would give us a notice of violation, and first thing that happens with a violation is they say you can add no new additional capacity to your, you know, or new additional customers or subdivisions to your plant and to your system until you address it. And so that's the real and present danger. Now, are we at the brink of that right now? No, we're not. But we are beginning to step up in a way that makes us concerned over the next, you know, 5 to 10 years that we can begin to get to that maximum on those maximum rain days. And so that's where the real, well, there's several things, but that's the real concern that can really hamper our ability to grow as a city. And so that's what really brings us to this point and one. And so most of the days, it's not a problem. It's, and no, it would never be a problem. But all it takes is one day to get a notice of violation, and then you're in real trouble. When I came 12 years ago, we were under a notice of violation. And so we don't want to be there again. I know that. So just a quick caveat as to why it's pretty important.
So earlier in the presentation, I talked about the two main categories of inflow and infiltration, mainline and manhole. Essentially, what you got manholes out there. We do need rehabilitation on those. The pipes that connect those two manholes are considered our mainlines. So as a point of reference as to what we're talking about here. Within our mainline inflow and infiltration issues, this is what the study produced. That study in 15 focused on the highest flow rates as far as stormwater. So not all basins are included within this, but it attacks the worst of the worst in that study. If you look at this, we have about about $6 million to fix 361 defects within our system on main lines. And what that would take is either replacing the pipe or lining it, which is a very, very expensive process to go through. The next one is manholes. Again, this is each end of the pipe. We have exactly 1,049 defects within the system that have been identified in these basins. In order to fix these, we need approximately 2.1 million. And that's where we get to the 8.1 total. So it splits between the group. Our goal would be to fix half of the remaining work and put us in a position to do the remaining half over the next probably 5 to 7 years in smaller increments. But this would put us in a really good position to take a bunch of stress off of our plant, avoid a violation and all of those things by fixing the worst of the worst. And to do half, we would need approximately $4,092,000. And we did do some estimations. I worked with Public Works, and if Nicolette, could you pull up that map? If we did the worst of the worst, which comes to approximately $3 million, we have a map here of the different areas that it would actually affect, and it's well spread throughout the city, so we'd be taking stress off of various points all over the city. If you can see, we have several up on the northeast, northwest, and south side of the city. There are various parts throughout the middle of the city that aren't as many, but there would be pieces there. And the goal is, if we could do that portion of work, it would take enough stress off of the main lines and infiltration on the manholes that we believe it would have a significant reduction in sewer backups. Because the majority of those sewer backups happen in big rain events when the lines are just overrun and can't keep up. So this would have secondary effects in the process as well. And not only taking the stress off of our plant. Thank you, Nick. The next area is health, negative economic and hardship, our hardest hit response. This is a combination of two areas within this legislation. But what it does is it gives flexibility to provide services and programs to assist the health response within the city, different economic impacts that have been had, and the hardest hit communities and lower income vulnerable populations. One of the various things we looked at on various programs is possibly putting $750,000 of this money towards those programs. Various programs we would like to explore, and again, these still need to go through a vetting process within the legislation, law, and all of that. So these are proposed while we still vet through. The city would like to purchase a notification system. Right now we're working with the county to use theirs, and we would like our own to be able to put out better response to boil orders, broken water mains, various emergencies that go on that we control, and we can make sure to get the messages out much quicker. The other area we are looking is a city mobile app, which will do various similar things to the as a notification, but also look to have schedules of events, to have bill pay options possibly, and look at a multitude of ranges where people can get access, because everybody has one of these things in their pocket, and they can access from there and get all the information they need about the city. Other areas, bill pay kiosks. With the soon, the city will be moving to the new city hall down the street. Our customer service will be moving to Osage. So that leaves opportunities for bill pay for various residents that like to walk up here. To be a little more limited, they would have to walk down to Osage because the new city hall won't have an access or a customer service point. We want to look at bill pay kiosks that we can place primarily at Shawnee Center and the new city hall. So the people in this area that are used to walking up to the city hall still have that option. There will still be people to interact with and different things like that, so we're looking at that option. You'll also see the city app is mentioned again. It actually is covered in multiple areas within this legislation. Support for vulnerable populations. We want to look at enhanced Shawnee programming at the Shawnee Center. Physical, mental health, and wellness programs, educational programs related to medical and health services, residential counseling and housing, navigation assistance. It's a very complicated process, and for some folks to have that help would help lead to some more home ownership and different things like that. Grant program to assist with home repairs, weatherization, HVAC, within our low-income areas. It would be a type of grant match where if an individual spends, say, $10,000, the city would match or reimburse them $5,000 of it. Just to do some improvements to their house, whether it be for ventilation, weatherization, those types of things to help improve the homes in those areas. A tuition reimbursement program for the vulnerable populations within certain census districts within our city. I know our city is struggling to find individuals with CDL. We have a location that has access to teaching that class. This program would help those individuals get that training and be reimbursed for it so they can get better jobs and not have to stay in the ones we're at with that training. One other thing is a one-time payment to community partnership or other organization for homeless assistance during inclement weather. And we estimate the total of all those projects to be no more than $750,000. As I stated, we are still vetting those through the legislation to ensure that they do apply or are applicable to these monies. Once we have that verification, we can then go through the process of a cost-benefit analysis to see if it's feasible and different things like that. But we believe focusing towards these programs are going to have the most benefit to the citizens and making sure to get the money where it needs to go. One other section that's covered in the legislation is premium pay. The act defines specific eligible workers who could receive up to $25,000 for premium pay. And as a part of the coronavirus response, and they are mostly first responders, teachers, social workers, health workers, etc. I fully appreciate everything those individuals did. But I also fully appreciate a list of people that aren't in that act. I know our Parks and Rec Department worked some really hard hours trying to find ways to get programming together, to get people out of the house, keep them safe, get them healthy, and all those other things. They're not on that list. We just feel the use of these funds for this purpose are against our One Cape methodology. While rewarding one piece of a big pie that helped navigate through this tough time, and we just don't feel is right, so we've decided not to allocate any funding to that. So our strategy, as I stated earlier, we have total funding is gonna be about $8.28 million total. We would like to allocate to lost public sector revenue $4.58 million. We would like to allocate towards sewer and stormwater infrastructure, the INI program, $2.95 million, and then other programs and services, as we defined a couple slides ago, we would like to allot $750,000. In the event we find some of these projects in the other programs and services not to be feasible, whether it be based on the legislation, based on cost benefit or anything like that, those funds would be allocated up into the INI program and do a little more of that work to try to get us closer to that $4 million mark. Questions?
Dustin, I just want to thank you. How many pages was the legislation that you had to read through?
151 pages, and I've read it six times.
Okay.
And I keep finding variations in it.
Usually anything that comes out from the federal government is fairly verbose, so thank you for going through all that and finding this information and helping us navigate this whole process.
Hi, Dustin. Just for clarification, so we can share with the public, who would be conducting the repairs on the sewer stormwater?
We would have outside contractors coming in to do it because of the complexity of the lining project. They are specialty contractors. One of the things, if this gets too deep in the weeds, please stop me, but one of the things in speaking with Public Works is when you get into mainline lining, it's a very specialized process, and there are certain contractors that do it. Typically, as you get over $1 million in a project, you start to see that cost per foot exponentially go down. So that's why we wanted to allocate so much to that and less on the manholes. Because with the manhole, the process, you don't gain that cost. Our economy of scale, essentially, is by bigger projects, you get a cheaper price. It doesn't work that way. Is that a fair way to say it, Sam?
What are the deadlines on spending this money?
All funds have to be spent by December 31st of 2024.
Okay. Are there any intermediate deadlines, like half now or any?
The only intermediate deadlines are actually the distribution. We have applied for our first round, which would be 50%. And then the second one comes 12 months later, based on what we read in that interim guidance.
I asked this next question only because I lived through PPP, two different rounds, and the second being much cleaner than the first. Do we foresee other more clarification on the 152 pages? Usually I think on PPP we had seven final rules. So you'd get a final rule, and then 3 days later you get another final rule. How confident are we that what we've got in our hands right now is?
I would be fairly confident in it. Keeping it to everything I've heard from the very beginning that has not wavered is they want some of this money spent on water, sewer infrastructure, that and broadband. That has never changed, and they've given us a wide range on that. Because there are so many communities that have so many varying issues within those broader sections, those communities need that flexibility to attack the sewer, water, and broadband issues they're fighting. So if that comes tighten it, if they come and tighten that down, I think what you're going to see is cities struggle to spend the money because everybody is different. I'll use Wyoming, for example. They have a struggle getting water. So they're going to focus a bunch of their money likely on pipelines to get the waters in from the basins and things. While we're struggling with stormwater, they don't get those rains. So every city throughout the country is so different, they got to keep those wide. When it comes to revenue recovery, there may be some tweaks in there, but we can adjust to those pretty easily. I don't have any fear that any adjustments we have to make there are going to have any negative impact on this plan. When it comes to the specialty projects, that funding we can sit back on because that would be the area we may have some changes. And we can sit back on those and wait to make sure we get that final ruling and then go through and verify them again, because we would like to get this going as quickly as possible. But on the same note, I don't want to write a check back to the feds because we misspent it. So we can sit back on those projects a little more while the others, I think, we're good to go.
The last thing I would say is in the inflow and infiltration piece, you know, when we built our new facility, you could argue that the money that we're putting into this is helping us to actually finalize that project. We spent 55, something like that, $55 million, it's almost $60 million on that wastewater treatment facility, and to think that we've got a third of our capability being used for stormwater, I mean, that's not efficient at all. And we shouldn't be putting our facility through that to begin with. So I think that piece is phenomenal that we're going to be able to attack some of that. And
I guess one way to look at it is when you buy a new car, you put good gas in it.
Absolutely.
And these lines that feed our plant, we got to have good inflow to stop the stress on the car. Because if you put bad gas in the car, it stops running. If we continue to do this to our plant, it's going to stop running, and we really don't want that to happen.
Absolutely. This coincides with our discussion last year also about, you know, why we charge tap fees and different things. It's about how much we can actually, as a city, take on. Well, we're using a third of that for things that we shouldn't be. And I know there's some areas in this town that when it rains, they do have some backup issues. This is going to address some of those issues as well. So thank you to staff for working. Dustin, thank you for all of your efforts on this. I know it was a lot of work, but we certainly appreciate it.
All right. Thanks, Dustin.
Thank you. Council, just one other comment. People might ask, well, why are we pushing forward now? Why are we running strategy now? And a couple of things. One of them is we're also doing our budget now. So by understanding kind of how this revenue replacement will work, that allows us to really balance ourselves going forward. And so that was important. Also, a new city manager, that gives them some flexibility to look and guide. And I think that will be important for him to have that flexibility. And the I&I program, we really need to get to work on that. And while we laid out a pretty good plan, there's still a lot of work that we need to do to vet through all this. So when we look at a line, we say, well, that was a line that was identified, but we might find some lines that when the river is up, stay underwater for months. Well, maybe we want to do that one instead of another piece. So those are things we want to vet through to make sure that we're doing the absolute most that will help us in the absolute most way. And while we think we're pretty good there, we've still got some vetting to do to find out all of that. That's going to take some engineering and some time to vet through that. So that's the reason we're really looking for those things. And then the $750,000, those projects, we wanted to try to kind of find out what was the things rising to the top that were important to you and important enough to look further in, and we'll need to vet through those. So that's the reason we want the direction, and we can move forward with that. So thank you for your consideration.
Yes.
On the sewer water,
Yes. Yes.
Okay, and so the relining and or reconstruction will cause this to go where? Straight into the river as waste, as sewer, as not sewer water, but as runoff?
Eventually.
Well, yeah, it just.
I mean, it's dispersed different, it's dispersed different in different places would eventually get to the river.
So basically the cost is involved is to separate.
Yes.
The runoff.
Yes.
Using the word separate, there, we had a whole program of separating our sewers years ago where years ago we put the stormwater with the sewer water. And, but years ago, I don't know what, years 60s, 70s maybe, we went in and separated them back then. But the pipes are still old, and sewer pipes that were laid prior to 1960s, they had joints in them made that allowed water in because dilution was the solution. And then later on, DNR comes back and says, dilution is not the solution.
Dilution is not the solution.
And so that's where we are. And so this is not uncommon among cities. You find it in every city has this challenge in front of them. We have come quite a ways, but we still have $8 million to do. And then if we did those $8 million, there would still be more because more is curated. But this will put us in a much better position and move us forward.
And thank you. In the past, the city has gone through some of this.
Yes.
I think if we would look back at the capital improvement plan, couldn't we see, I mean, this is going to directly impact other projects getting moved cleaner or moved up sooner than they normally would due to us being able to do this out with federal funds instead of out of our own funds. It'll be interesting to see what projects can get moved up. And anyway, thank you again, Dustin and staff.
All right, communication and reports. Council? Anybody? I would remind everybody about the library ribbon cutting Wednesday at 10:30. I apologize beforehand. I have a Paducah mayor coming to Cape Wednesday for a meeting. We have prearranged this twice, and he had to reschedule once, and I had to reschedule once. We're in a little kind of tete-a-tete about what goes on in different cities. He wants to see things going on in our city, and specifically he'd like to look at maybe the wastewater treatment plant and some others. I don't know. I'll find out when he gets here, and then I'll figure that out. So,
Mayor, I did have one.
Sorry. Yes.
I actually had two. I attended SIMPO last month for you. A lot of great things going on, Scott, and are more versed in SIMPO. That's only been my second or third SIMPO meeting ever.
You get to go again next month.
Okay. Thank you, Mayor.
I'll be gone again.
So a lot of different projects going on with that. And then also Magnet update. The contract with Ernst & Young has been signed tomorrow at 3 p.m. We've got a kickoff call with Ernst & Young. The subcommittee group on that in Magnet is Dr. Stapleton with Codify, Charlie Herbst with the county, and myself. So I think, and we're going to have a lot more information going out. Nicolette is actually helping with some of that information to get out. Ernst & Young over the next 6 months will be conducting focus groups and questions and answer sections to be able to get a lot about what our economic viability or economic culture and economic development, what that looks like to everyone in our community. So I'm very excited about that. We've done a lot of different things and are going to continue to with that. So more news to come.
I got one. Regrettably, I was not able to attend it. I was about an hour late, but this past Friday there was an open house ribbon cutting for Community Partnership at their new facility, the old police station down on Sprigg Street. And I think they welcome tours. I don't know. I can't wait to get my tour, but I was not there to get it at that time. But it was a great event from what I've heard for a great, valuable organization in our community.
Yes, I'm sorry I missed that one too. So Staff, Scott, anything else?
I want to mention the Summer Arts Festival at River Campus. That'll be the week of June 19th. I believe the performances are June 19th from 10 to 5 p.m. Free admission, performances, art, a lot of kids' stuff leading up to that, and you should be seeing more on social media and others. So it's an opportunity to be a part of, if you have kids especially, the Summer Arts Festival.
Anything else? Glad to have you back. Appearances by advisory board applicants. I think we have a couple here this evening. At least they signed up to be here, registered to be here. No appearances by advisory board applicants.
Thank you.
Good evening. Don't worry, I've only got two pages. Thanks for letting me speak. My name is Nathan Bullock, and I wanted to express interest in joining the advisory board, particularly for the library. I currently serve as Dean of Extended Studies at Southwest Missouri State, and in that role, I oversee our regional campuses, our online programs, and our dual credit programs. I'm pretty new to Cape Girardeau. I moved here last year for this position, but not new to Southeast Missouri. I grew up a little further south in the Boot Hill, coming back here was getting closer to family and things like that. My qualification for the role include graduate degrees in both public administration and in management, as well as a doctoral degree that, Lord willing, I'll complete in about a year or so in applied learning sciences. I have about 20 years of experience in higher education administration, which includes overseeing areas that I think would be helpful in a public library board setting, which would include financial management, strategic planning, human resource management, and the design and implementation of educational programs. My interest in the position was kind of twofold. One was I always kind of look for an opportunity to give back to communities wherever I am, so I feel like that's an opportunity to do that here. And I kind of feel like there's very few places that provide quite as many resources to a community as the library does. Secondly, I really believe strongly as an educator, having worked in education my entire career, in the power of literacy and reading to transform lives. I think I can pretty safely say that I wouldn't be where I am today without public libraries and like what they afford to us. And I kind of feel like, you know, really for many of us, before we ever had the chance to travel abroad, myself included, that, you know, books and reading and libraries opened up that world to us. I of course know that today libraries have evolved far beyond just places where books are contained. I know that I've personally visited public libraries for study space over the years, notary services, lectures, Wi-Fi access when I was working remotely, to check out ebooks, audiobooks, and all those sorts of things. So I know there's a wide variety of tasks that get served by the library. Professor David Lankes, who's at Syracuse University and now dean of their library school, says that bad libraries build collections, good libraries build services, and great libraries build communities. And I'd like to be a part, if possible, of helping our public library continue to build be a great library that builds great communities in Cape Girardeau. And I'm happy to answer any questions. Like I said, I keep it short.
Anybody have any questions? Thank you. Thank you for coming.
Thank you, guys. Appreciate it.
All right.
Thank you very much.
Anybody else? The advisory board? If not, are there any appearances this evening for any items not on the agenda? Any appearances for any item that is not on the agenda this evening? If not, we will move into agenda review. Scott?
Thank you, Mayor. We do have one public hearing tonight. It'll be a public hearing for Community Partnership, actually celebrating their building. The grant for that requires that after the completion of the project that a public hearing be held, and so we'll be holding that tonight and be a good time to celebrate that accomplishment. We will have on our consent agenda, we have
The second and third readings of the redevelopment project area downtown on William Street, both the redevelopment project and the redevelopment agreement, and that's number four. And then we have the record plat for Coyote Creek, third subdivision. And then we have license and indemnity agreement for Brennan Tott, which is also at 101 William Street. This is for, I believe, a fence and a retaining wall on right-of-way for that improvement. And so this is a license and indemnity agreement for that. And then we have a series of what we call on-call contracts for consultants to do work for us. In this case, it's particularly for Transportation Trust Fund 6. And so we have a series of those. Number 7 is for Bowen Engineering. Number 8 is for the Kaler Engineering. Number 9 is for Cook, Flat, and Strobel. So each of those will be a resolution tonight to enter into those agreements. Then we have an agreement for a contract for streetlight replacement and a fiber installation in accordance or in combination with the DDI project that MoDOT is doing, that awarding that to Cotner Electric. Number 11 is the performance guarantee for Collins Mill subdivision, phase 3. 12 is an agreement with Crawford Murphy and Tilly out at the airport to do the environmental and NEPA documentation at the new terminal project. Crawford Murphy and Tilly is a good partner out at the airport, and we do have done several projects with them and have great luck. And then number 13 is our essential air service contract and the recommendation that to the U.S. Department of Transportation that we award that to SkyWest Airlines, who we currently have our agreement with, and so extending that contract. That is the consent agenda, and then we have two items that we've removed from the consent agenda, both of those related to the budget. We just have some small amendments to those. The first one is for the solid waste fees. We did have the fee in there for the disconnect, but we didn't have the right number. We like to have an even number so it's easier to make change. And so we'll be asking you for a amendment there, a small amendment there. And then in 15, in the budget, we had for the magnet contract. Under that contract, we have $50,000 each year to make available for a company that's coming in, and we failed to put that money in that line item, so we need to add that money to the line item. So those are the reasons why we remove those, and we'll be asking for those amendments. Are there any other questions or items you want to remove from the consent agenda? If not, we've got the new ordinances. We have a record plat for Frederick subdivision, first reading for that. We then have the stormwater change in chapter 25. If you recall, several months ago, we had meetings and we were trying to get developers out to talk about the fact that the state was requiring us to change how we do easements on some of our stormwater facilities, that we were going to require easements and that they be recorded. We advertised that as much as we could. We had the public hearing. We sent it out to our developers roundtable group. Well, now then, this is the point now where we need you to all to take action. So, and putting that in place. And we have had issues where we had stormwater that was put in place, but there were no there was nothing in the deeds, and then it wasn't taken care of, and then we were in a pickle at the end. And so this will protect citizens by doing that. Number 18 is the state court automation. So this is a automation that is required by the state. They allow us to do a surcharge in order to help pay for it. So I guess it's not an unpaid or an unfunded mandate. So this is that surcharge. The only time it will really end up costing us is if they're between the fine and the court cost, if it reaches the maximum. And if it's already going to reach the maximum, then this would be somewhat less. But that won't happen a lot. We don't think the cost is going to be a lot for us, but it is something that that is mandated, and it will be on all of our court costs going forward. Our transportation planning consolidated grant for SIMPO. This is a yearly thing. Number 19, number 20 is the capital expenditures. This is for the mural. You ask us to put this on for reading and discussion tonight. This is for a capital improvement expenditure of $50,000, which is what they had asked for. Subsequently, they've also have applied for a grant and asked for a letter of support for that, which the mayor provided. I did check with them. If they do get the grant, then that would, that would be less money that they would need from us. They also think now refined their estimates a little bit more. I think they're now at 52,000 and something in the in what they don't have in order to do this, to do the project. So that's for your consideration tonight. Number 21 is the annexation. Last time we did a hearing for the annexation. This is the first reading of that annexation for the Canes out on 3920 Bloomfield Road. And then subsequently in 22, that's changing the boundaries of Ward 6 for that property. And then the zoning of the property is going to be R1, and that is number 23. And I believe that is all, Mayor, unless you have any questions.
Anybody have any questions for Scott? On agenda review? If not, we will roll right into regular session and have the call to order. We are now in regular session. We'll have roll call.
Mayor Fox?
Here.
Ms. Kinder's absent. Mr. Gard?
Here.
Ms. Moore?
Here.
Mr. Presson?
Here.
Mr. Thomas?
Here.
Ms. Truxell?
Here.
I will entertain a motion to adopt the agenda.
Move.
Second.
Motion by Dan, second by Robbie. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Your agenda has been adopted. We do have one public hearing this evening, the public hearing to discuss Community Partnership of Southeast Missouri's past performance in carrying out the project for the construction renovation of the Old Cape Police Headquarters. Ms. Melissa.
Good evening, I'm Dr. Melissa Sickle. I serve as the Executive Director of Community Partnership of Southeast Missouri. And as Scott mentioned earlier, we needed to have a public hearing as part of our closeout for the Community Development Block Grant. So I'm here to give you a little brief overview of that project, where we're at with that. And I also have Margaret Yates with SEMO Regional Planning Commission here if you have any questions about the project. All right, so just as a recap for everybody, in 2019, we made application for the Community Development Block Grant under the Community Facilities in order to acquire and rehab the former Cape Girardeau Police Station. And we actually finally closed on that project. Margaret was just telling me that we officially closed or were awarded March of 2020. And so we are just now in the completion phase, just over a year later. All right, so as a reminder, one of the reasons that this entity and the city partnered with our agency is because of all of the work that we do in the community around vulnerable populations, particularly our work in the homelessness prevention, but also working with vulnerable families and looking at our transformation of neighborhoods and all that, the work that we do, particularly with low to moderate income, which was one of the defining factors of the Community Development Block Grant. So for everybody who didn't see the former police station, it was quite a mess. I'm sure that this council understands well of what that looked like. When we went into this project, we knew that we were going to have to do quite an extensive demolition and remodel. We actually gutted the entire building from top to bottom. In fact, we thought we were going to get away with replacing the roof or fixing the roof, we ended up having to do a full replacement. Our total project investment in this building is $1.87 million. Our CDBG amount was $500,000. Maybe. All right, so these are just some pictures of the demolition. You can see us tearing down walls. Again, every single wall in that facility was taken out, wiped out, flooring, ceiling, plumbing, electricity, HVAC, every little bit of it. I don't think, we're gonna see if this is gonna work. We did a nifty 360 degree of our jailhouse space, so I don't, nope, not gonna work. All right, so well, as everybody knows, the Cape Girardeau Police Station building also housed our Cape Girardeau jail facility. I don't think it's gonna work, Nicolette. Yes, it's being persnickety. Oh, wait, there we go. All right, so there's one of the holding cells. Thank you, Nicolette, for making that work. All right, here you can see is when we were right at the final stages of remodel, putting in cabinets. Oh, sorry, all right, there we go. Here you can see some of the other pieces. If you notice the bottom picture, that's real fun. That's actually that holding cell that you just saw. We actually kept some of the bars. If you have not come by, we're gonna skip over that, Nicolette, I think. If you have not come by for your personal tour, and if you were not able to come to the open house, you certainly need to come by and check out the space. Essentially, what we have done is we've created this space where we can offer some critical services to our vulnerable population, one of which is called the Neighbor Hub. This was one of the spaces that we defined in our application to CDBG that was essential for this community. We offer showers and laundry and space for our neighbors that are experiencing homelessness to come in the day and take a shower and get their bellies warmed, but more importantly, also connect with our housing services. We've also created space where we're able to collaborate better with our partners. That's one of the great things that our agency does. Hence community partnerships. So we work with multiple agencies, multiple organizations, and we now have this fantastic space to do that. In that holding cell you saw, we created something called Jailhouse Cafe. It is an actual little coffee shop, but it's a training site for people that are reentering from incarceration so that they can learn job skills and soft skills and also build their resume. I'll get my act together. I think that's a video. I know, it doesn't like me. Is that gonna play? There we go. See, it might not have volume. For those of you who missed our open house, it had good music.
You could sing for us.
So what's remarkable about that open house is we had about 300 people come through. We also had seven chambers simultaneously doing a ribbon cutting from Perryville all the way to Poplar Bluff. So we have quite an extensive service area, as most of you do know, and we were able to, I think, conduct one of the largest simultaneous chamber ribbon cuttings in history all at one time. So we have 35 staff that are operating out of this building, plus another 10 interns, AmeriCorps, Vista, and volunteers. We all got nice t-shirts that say we survived, barely. And I just wanted to extend a thank you to the city of Cape Girardeau for being part of this project. We absolutely could not 100% have not done it without you. This was a grant that was awarded to the City of Cape and then was subcontracted to our agency for completion. And so when I tell people that this is a community facility, it's a community facility. It's not just the Community Partnership of Southeast Missouri building. This is designed for the city to use and the people that live in it. And we're just excited to be done. I think that's it. All right, any questions on the project?
I think it turned out great for what it looked like beforehand. I haven't seen the inside of it yet, other than the pictures, but I can tell you with all the services you provide in cooperation with everybody else, we thank you.
Well, thank you. Definitely need to come by for your personal tour, Mayor.
Will do.
Thank you, Melissa. Great job.
Thank you.
Any appearances this evening for any item that's on the agenda? Any item that's listed on the agenda? If not, we'll move to the consent agenda. Okay.
Bill 2173, an ordinance approving a redevelopment project for the redevelopment project area 2 of the downtown Cape Girardeau redevelopment area, adopting tax increment financing with respect thereto and authorizing certain actions by city officials. Bill 2173, an ordinance approving a redevelopment project for redevelopment project area 2 of the downtown Cape Girardeau redevelopment area, adopting tax increment financing with respect thereto and authorizing certain actions by city officials. Bill 2174, an ordinance approving a redevelopment agreement in connection with a portion of RPA 2 redevelopment project described in the redevelopment plan for the Downtown Tax Increment Financing District, Cape Girardeau, Missouri, 2015. Bill 2174, an ordinance approving a redevelopment agreement in connection with a portion of RPA 2 redevelopment project described in the redevelopment plan for the Downtown Tax Increment Financing District, Cape Girardeau, Missouri, 2015. Bill 2177, an ordinance approving the record plat of Coyote Creek 3rd Subdivision. Bill 2177, an ordinance approving the record plat of Coyote Creek 3rd Subdivision. Bill 2178, a resolution authorizing the city manager to execute a license and indemnity agreement with Brendan Todd for various outdoor improvements at 101 William Street in the city of Cape Girardeau, Missouri. Bill 2179, a resolution authorizing the city manager to execute an agreement with Bowen Engineering and Surveying for the Transportation Trust Fund 6 projects in the city of Cape Girardeau, Missouri. Bill 2180, a resolution authorizing the city manager to execute an agreement with Kaler Engineering and Land Surveying Inc. for the Transportation Trust Fund 6 projects in the city of Cape Girardeau, Missouri. Bill 2181, a resolution authorizing the city manager to execute an agreement with Cook, Flat, and Strobel Engineering's PA for the Transportation Trust Fund 6 projects in the city of Cape Girardeau, Missouri. Bill 2182, a resolution authorizing the city manager to execute an agreement with Cotner Electric Company, Inc. for the DBI Streetlight Replacement Fire Station 2 fire burst installation in the city of Cape Girardeau, Missouri. Bill 2183, a resolution authorizing the city manager to execute a performance guarantee agreement with Collins Mill Development Group, LLC for the Collins Mill Subdivision Phase 3 in the city of Cape Girardeau, Missouri. Bill 2184, a resolution authorizing the city manager to execute an agreement with Crawford, Murphy, and Tilley, Inc. for the environmental services and NEPA documentation for the new passenger terminal project at the Cape Girardeau Regional Airport. Bill 2185, a resolution authorizing the city manager to make recommendations to the United States Department of Transportation for SkyWest Airlines to provide an air carrier service under the Essential Air Service Program at the Cape Girardeau Regional Airport.
You have before you the consent agenda.
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Robbie and seconded by Dan. Any discussion?
Mayor, please mark my vote for number 11, an abstention due to financial conflict of interest.
Will do. And I would comment that the air carrier service for the Essential Air Program is a 3-year contract, is it not? Good.
Yeah, I want to comment. We passed that in 2017, if I'm not mistaken, and I have always been so excited to be able to fly, get there, and to see what we've been able to do. Katrina and the rest of the airport board, thank you. I think everybody that I've talked to loves that service and glad to have SkyWest back for another 3 years. Wish they'd do longer.
I do.
Thank you for your leadership on that, everybody.
You have before you the consent agenda. Any further discussion? If not, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? That motion carries. We have two items removed from the consent agenda. One is Bill number 2175, an ordinance establishing utility rates for the city of Cape Girardeau, Missouri by amending chapter 22 relating to solid waste fees and chapter 29 relating to water rates. An ordinance establishing utility rates for the city of Cape Girardeau, Missouri by amending chapter 22 relating to solid waste fees and chapter 29 relating to water rates.
Okay.
Motion's been made. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Seconded by Dan. In discussion here, we do would like to offer an amendment to add the disconnect, fees for disconnect that were, here we go.
Council, if you go to page 8 of the ordinance, the section reads a fee of $18. We want to change that from 17 cents to 15 for ease of making change that was found since last meeting. And all the changes will be within that one paragraph. The second piece is changing the reconnection or reinstitution charge from $36.30 from $36.34. It is just a minor change, but it makes so much ease. It's less than $100 of revenue, but when you're dealing with balancing and having our staff make change in away from normal circumstances, like you don't have the comfort of the bank and everything, it makes it much easier on them. It's a pretty minor fee change.
Okay.
Submoved to the amendment.
Second to the amendment.
Okay, we have a motion and a second for the amendment. Any discussion on the amendment? If not, all those in favor of the amendment signify by saying aye.
Aye.
You now have an amended motion. Any discussion on the amended motion?
Our discussion. The only thing I wanted to say, and I'm glad that staff put that in there, since I've been on council, we have been able to keep, I know we have a rate and we get hammered for it every time we do, but if you look at the last 9 years, it's been pretty much lower than the inflation rate, and an average of 1.24% over the last 9 years increase. As hard as it is to get employees in today's society and everything, all the other cost increases that we are seeing, I am extremely proud that we've been able to limit how much we put a burden on the resident and for the service we have. I mean, we built a $60 million facility, and to remain to be very competitive with our rates is phenomenal. So I know there's still going to be people say any increase is a horrible thing, but I think staff has done a heck of a job. Kudos to Stan and kudos to Dustin and Scott for being cognizant of the resident in mind every year. So anyway, that's my soapbox on that.
You have before you the amended motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? That motion carries. Bill number 21-76, an ordinance adopting the annual operating budget for the city of Cape Girardeau, Missouri for the fiscal year beginning July 1st, 2021. An ordinance adopting the annual operating budget for the city of Cape Girardeau, Missouri for the fiscal year beginning July 1st, 2021. Motion by Dan.
I'd like to offer an amendment to that.
Can I have a second on that motion first?
Oh, second.
Seconded by Rob. Okay.
I'd like to make an amendment to a budget to allow for the additional $50,000 to Magnet, which is specified within the contract.
Do I hear a second?
I'll move to the amendment.
You second the amendment?
Second the amendment.
Okay. We have an amendment that's been made and seconded. Dustin, any comments?
Can we reference that to general fund specifically?
Oh, sorry. To the general fund.
We'll accept that.
From
as
the general fund, sorry. Let me start over.
We'll accept that as an editorial change.
We got it.
We'll accept that as an editorial change.
Correct.
Okay.
Hey, I did.
You have before you the amendment. Any discussion on the amendment? If not, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? That motion carries. You have before you now the amended budget, which we, all those in favor of the amended budget signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? That motion carries. New or, yes.
You need to, I want to say this so that it can go on the record. There are increases for, within development services, and they were increases that we had, that the developers had heartburn with it last year. We went ahead and made the increases this year. There are increases across the board, and our costs are going up as well. And so we're going to be getting contacted, I know, but it is imperative that we get these increases done now, especially in the environment we are right now. So I hate to do it, but it's part of it. Sorry. Anyway, I want to throw that out there. We discussed it. We said it.
Yes.
And there are also increases in parks and rec fees and others. And so that was discussed multiple times, starting at council retreat. And one of the things that we worked really hard on this year was increasing the service, especially to developers. And we greatly reduced our turnaround time on plans and things like that. So we want to make sure that they understand we're also getting value for those increases.
And we're receiving a lot of positive comments about that too. So that's a good thing.
And I'd like to throw in there, if we were successful in passing our internet sales tax, it would make it a lot easier to where we wouldn't have to raise these rates every time.
That's true.
General fund our budget.
That is true.
That was smart.
We'll discuss that in a moment. New ordinances. Bill number 21-86, an ordinance approving the record plat of Frederick Subdivision Number 1.
So moved.
Motion by Dan.
Second.
Seconded by Shelley. Any discussion? If not, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? That motion carries. Bill number 21-87, an ordinance amending Chapter 25 of the Code of Ordinances of the City of Cape Girardeau, Missouri regarding stormwater management facilities.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Robbie, seconded by Nate. Any discussion? If not, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? That motion carries. Bill number 21-88, an ordinance amending Chapter 16 of the Code of Ordinances of the City of Cape Girardeau, Missouri regarding state court automation surcharge.
So moved.
Motion by Shannon.
Second.
Seconded by Dan. Any discussion? If not, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? That motion carries. And Bill number 21-89, an ordinance authorizing the city manager to execute a transportation planning consolidated grant and agreement with the Missouri Highways and Transportation Commission for Southeast Metropolitan Planning Organization expenses in the city of Cape Girardeau, Missouri.
So moved.
Motion by Robbie, seconded by Shelley. Any discussion? If not, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? That motion carries. Bill number 2190. An ordinance appropriating funds for capital expenditures for the fiscal year ending June 30th, 2021, the City of Cape Girardeau, Missouri.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? This is funds for the mural. Mm-hmm. And I would like to see us appropriate the $52,800 with the contention that that would be reduced by any receipt of grant funds.
Of $50,000? Expecting that they would get $50,000?
If they get $50,000, then all we have to expend is $2,800.
Right.
So you're offering amendment?
Yes.
So the amendment would be to
change the dollar amount.
Change the dollar amount to $52,800.
So moved.
Motion made and seconded. Any other discussion? If they get $25,000 in grant funds, then it lowers it by that amount. I don't know what the status is of the grant, but.
So is that part of your motion, Mayor, that it
yes.
also is reduced by
yes.
any grant funds that they receive?
Yes.
Contingent upon issuance of the grant funding. That's
right.
What basically saying. Hopefully they'll get off.
Did they indicate what the dollar amount was of the grant that they were?
I think they applied for $50,000.
They applied for $50,000.
Now, if they get the grant, then all we expend is $2,800.
So the motion, the motion is for the 52,000.
800.
800, but will be reduced by any.
Any grant funds received.
That they receive.
I would not narrow it just to grant funding, but any additional funding sources that they receive, such as if they have a private campaign, capital fundraising campaign, or they get a donor, that is reduced by that also. Because I would like to encourage them to seek other.
Correct.
Partners in funding the project.
You're saying minus any grant receipts or other contributions.
Perfect.
That perfect?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
Although.
Timeframe on this?
Well, isn't the answer supposed to be received by July 13th or something?
For the one grant that they've already applied for.
Yeah.
Should know.
And on the donations.
They're going to, the donations, so they're going to have a plan to paint it starting when? We don't have the timeframe.
I don't have.
We don't have the timeframe, they gotta take it off first.
Yeah.
August 1st?
I don't know. I don't know if there needs to be a timeframe there, we have, we're.
So anytime they get any grant or any contribution.
I think it does seem like we need to get some sort of timeframe in it, you know, so that, you know, any funds received by August 1st, you know, then we'll kick in whatever fund. Because otherwise, what if they receive a grant in January? So, do you think we need a timeframe?
Is nobody here representing?
Nobody's here representing them, I.
I mean, if it's appropriated within the capital.
If it's appropriated within the capital expenditures, it can be any time the fiscal year.
In the next fiscal year.
Okay, because.
I would give them time to completion, because once they start, they may get something later.
Well, there you go, yeah, time to completion.
Right.
I would agree.
Time of completion. So, what we're saying is.
You wanna read the motion?
I will.
I have Mr. Guard, you made the motion to, no, to approve. Mr. Guard, you made the motion to amend, seconded by Ms. Moore. To clarify your motion, I'm asking, you're changing the appropriation to 52,800, correct? With the condition that it would be reduced by the receipt of any grant funds, you said grant funds, are you amending that to?
I would say it would be amended to 52,800. Right. Any contributions or grant funds that are received.
Prior to completion.
Prior to completion.
Of the mural.
Of the mural.
Great, define completion.
Is that?
Yeah, we don't wanna have a mural.
Okay. Everybody understand the motion? Any more discussion?
I just wanna be on record that I would, I mean, it's a great project, and it's gonna be, it would be a great addition as you're coming across the bridge. But just encourage them to continue seeking other funding mechanisms in addition to us showing that we are committed to the project, for them to also seek out other funding opportunities or grants or private funds.
Okay.
Just to clarify, you've phrased your amendment receipt of the funds, so that would preclude reduction by a grant that was approved, but the funds had not yet been received.
I would think you could awarded.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Instead of received, awarded.
Okay.
Okay, awarded.
Yeah.
Put awarded.
Yeah.
We accept that editorial change. Okay, any further discussion? Any further comments? If not, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? That motion carries. Bill number 2191.
You now need to make.
Oh, I'm sorry, we did vote on the amendment. Bill number, now, we have an amended resolution, ordinance 21-90.
So moved.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? That motion carries. Sorry, got carried away there with, we talked about it so much.
We try to keep straight.
Keep me on, keep me, she will keep me in line.
Yes.
Bill number 2191, an ordinance annexing land near the city limits of Cape Girardeau, Missouri, located at 3920 Bloomfield Road upon the request of Justin A. Kane and Carrie A. Kane.
So moved.
Motion by Nate, seconded by Dan. Any discussion? If not, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? That motion carries. Bill number 21-92, an ordinance extending the boundaries of Ward 6 to include property newly annexed in the city limits of Cape Girardeau, Missouri.
So moved.
Motion by Dan, seconded by Shannon. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? That motion carries. And the last one dealing with the annexation, and Bill number 21-93, an ordinance amending Chapter 30 of the Code of Ordinances of the City of Cape Girardeau, Missouri, by zoning the newly annexed property located at 3920 Bloomfield Road as R1.
So moved.
Second.
Which is single family suburban residential district. Didn't turn that over. We have a motion. Any discussion on that? If not, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? That motion carries. We have no appointments this evening. Under other business, I did want to have a short discussion on the item which we're going to put on the study session agenda next meeting, which will be the decision on whether we want to put a use tax on the ballot in November.
Well, first off, do we have to call it use tax?
We call it a leveling the playing field with small businesses.
Or how about just internet sales
internet
tax?
I refer to it as internet sales tax. I always have. I'm not sure what the legislation specifically.
I would like to know if we can refer to it other than a use tax.
I believe the legislation actually gives the wording of what the ballot will have to say. You can refer to it, I think, and
Whatever terms you want.
It's good, especially if we continue to start talking about it as an internet sales tax.
It's definitely an internet sales tax.
Well, that's
what it is.
That's what it is.
Internet sales tax. Let's say it a couple more times. Because
internet sales
people
tax.
Have to realize that that is exactly what this issue is up against, is
yep.
that it is competing our, you know, it is pitting our small businesses against behemoth companies that are currently not paying sales tax.
Well, to me, and Scott pointed this out, the biggest issue is that you have, say, just one company, specifically Amazon, who delivers thousands and thousands and thousands of packages in our city, uses our streets. People get them stolen off their front porch. They call our police to come and take care of that issue. And all of this at a cost to us and our citizens that they're getting for nothing, and all they're doing is making a fortune. That is a big issue. That is the issue, in my mind. I will say, if it goes on the ballot November 2nd, the last regular council meeting date for the first reading calling for the election would be July 19th. The last for the second and third readings will be the next meeting on August 2nd, because notice has to be given to the election authority on August 24th. At our lunch today, Jackson is also investigating whether to do this in November. Scott City is willing to do it also. I would like to see collectively our area come together because we all need to do the same thing. The state has said if you want this to work and collect this internet tax, you have to pass it locally. So it, you know, it's on us.
Very soon.
And on our citizens, and on us to educate the people as to why this has to happen and what the ramifications will be if it's not. That was any other discussion on this at all?
My only question was, if there's specific ballot language that the, could staff get that to the council, like, as soon as possible?
We should have that, hopefully, by our study session next month.
To go off Scott's point, though, I think that the key part of this is not just what the ballot language is, but that we have a clear, concise, consistent message, not convoluted, across all the municipalities around our area that are all going for the same issue, and that's what's going to be important. And so as much as we can work in concert with them, so the same message is being spoken by the people that are all working together in our community and all the surrounding communities.
Well, it's communities all across Missouri, and Dwayne Haas, the mayor of Jackson, is on the MML Board of Directors. He is seeking their consultation on this to see where they stand on this and as far as what has to happen statewide.
It just can't get convoluted, like the use tax, like what is a use tax? It just needs to be, no, this is internet sales tax. And then even as it was evidenced earlier today when we were approving our budget, if we can't, if we're losing sales because we can't collect internet sales tax, we're losing sales tax revenue, it's going to have a effect across all the other budgetary items that we have. And so if people complain that other fees are going up, it's because we have to, in order to provide the services in our community for those Amazon trucks that are traveling down our roads and everybody else, we have to be able to raise the funds to be budget neutral.
Okay. Any other discussion on this? It will be on the study session next meeting. The other item is to have a discussion on the strategies for the American Rescue Plan funds, which we are supposed to get one of these days, I hope. Any comments on the strategy that was presented tonight?
I thought Dustin and the city staff put together an incredible opportunity for us to utilize these funds, especially when it comes to one issue that this community understands, which is rainwater, stormwater, all of that issue. If you looked at that map that Dustin presented us this evening, there's a lot of manhole issues, there's a lot of mainline issues in Ward 1. We're an older neighborhood. We've got hills and streams, and we're used to flooding and everything. So I can understand this from a neighborhood perspective of how important it is for us to make these mainline inflow and infiltration fixes. In the long run, it helps us. It makes sure that our door is always open to economic development. It always allows us to be able to tap into that potential, and it eliminates, you know, a huge percentage of stormwater that's going to get treated, you know, in our...
Well, that's got to reduce the cost of operating this stormwater.
It's going to reduce that cost. So I just think the city has put together an incredibly well-organized thought process when it comes to how to utilize these funds. And I'm very appreciative of the city staff for doing that.
Well, they've done that within the guidelines presented by the federal government, too. That's the important thing.
I mean, you hit the nail right on the head. It's an I&I, which we all become familiar with that term through all these discussions, but it's really an economic development investment because it's increasing our ability to take on capacity from other economic development opportunities that may move into our area. But I also wanted to commend the staff. I hope, much to Robbie's point earlier, this isn't a moving target. It doesn't change too much in the final ruling. But given what we have a good roadmap in place with our projects in the 750,000 that council directed projects. I think it's a good list, and we'll get some good insight as you guys look into those as far as prioritization of those as we go forward. So
I would think that the only thing I would say is do we want to adopt this as a council policy?
I think it's something that we'd have staff bring back at another meeting.
I think what we'd like is a motion to move forward with this strategy. All this stuff will have to come back to you in detail when we do the appropriation, when we do the contracts, when we do everything. It'll all come back. But what we'd like, what helps us is if you would endorse it with a motion to say proceed with this. So that then that gives us, okay, now we have direction. Now we can do all that due diligence work that needs to be happened instead of looking at a huge universe. Now then we can do that. So
I would make a motion to accept that strategy that was presented by Dustin Zeebo.
I would second that motion.
Okay, motion been made and seconded. Any further discussion? I mean, there's still a lot of things up in the air. As you look at the other projects, we don't know for sure how that's going to be interpreted. But the strategy itself at least gives us direction to give staff direction to begin that process and do it wisely and do it that'll benefit the public and I think in the best interest. So all those in favor of that signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? That motion carries. I have no other business, and we do not have a closed session this evening, so I'll entertain a motion that we adjourn this meeting. All those in favor say aye. Boom, we're adjourned.
I was gonna sit. I was enjoying discussion, guys.